So welcome to the 1,000 subscriber video special. I said I'd do something special involving a visit, and this is it. The National Cycle Museum in Llandrindod Wells. Beautiful spa town in mid Wales. One of my favourite places. It used to be called the National Cycle Collection, then it took on the role of museum when it amalgamated with the former cycle museum that had been in Lincoln. So, we're going to go in. I'm going to give you a bit of a whistle stop tour. We can't do the whole, we'd be here for hours if we did the whole lot. I'm going to pick some highlights for you. As you can probably hear, my voice is a bit croaky today. So I apologise for the croakiness, because I'm also going to have to keep my voice down somewhat as the museum is open, and I don't want to be bothering people. I don't want to be that guy, as they say. So, here we go. Buffer. So here we are, the National Cycle Museum, Llandrindod Wells. I haven't been here for quite a few years, so it's nice to be back. Unfortunately, we're right next to the office and there's a conversation taking place in the office. So rather than do the exhaustive virtual tour, I'm just going to show you some highlights, give you a flavour of the place. So we've come in from the entrance. I'll show you the foyer later, which has some interesting photographic displays. And of course, as a museum which traces the history of cycling, we start at the beginning with an early hobby horse running machine. 1818, although this of course is a replica, and there's also a copy of Kirkpatrick Macmillan's treadle powered machine from Dumfriesshire, which is fairly universally acknowledged to be the first proper bicycle, or the first bicycle machine that can be called that. Still with a horse's head on the front. Lots of memorabilia everywhere. For many people, even non-cycling people, the cabinets of memorabilia are often the most interesting part of the museum. This is a favourite of mine. This is a salvo, a Starley salvo from 1880. And although they've worked out the chain drive, for some reason they've got equal size sprockets still and using the large wheels. They could of course have geared it down and used smaller wheels, but maybe the penny hadn't dropped then. Speaking of pennies, here we're going from the Velocipede, the bone shaker, with its leg rests. So we're descending a hill, you just put your legs up over there as the pedals go spinning away by themselves. Iron tyres of course, hence the nickname Bone Shaker. And then from the Velocipede straight into the Ordinary. You can see the development of the Velocipede as the front wheel gets bigger and the back wheel smaller, and then into what we know as the Ordinary, or what was known as the Ordinary, and we know as the High Wheeler, or to nickname it the Penny Farthing. And you can see the development here. They've got a lovely line-up of the development of the, let's call it the penny for the sake of this video. Starting off with solid forks, radial spokes. Still got a tubular backbone. It's commonly acknowledged that steel tubing was developed for the bicycle industry, and without it, the aircraft industry could never have taken off, sorry for the pun. The Wright brothers, of course, being bicycle manufacturers anyway. And slightly out of the time sequence, there's some lovely early safeties up here as well, some lovely solid tired safety there. A star, apparently, will go the frame. And see the twin down tubes there and the twin seat tubes. Because they were still developing the safety bicycle, they hadn't yet arrived at the diamond frame as the standard by that time. But back to the ordinaries. As we progress down the line, we see things like the steering mechanisms being refined, different pivoting mechanisms for the steering. Lovely integrated headset on this one. And then the forks eventually go tubular. That's still a solid one. And another major development for the future of the industry occurs further down the line here with the advent of tangent spokes. There we are. The first cross spokes. These are much better for delivering torque when you're pushing hard on the pedal. Radial spokes can just twist up a little bit, they load up and then release the load, giving us a springy, spongy motion if the wheel isn't perfectly built. And tangent spokes, because they're going at an angle, they're better placed to absorb either the power stroke or indeed braking, the backstroke. And on a modern bicycle, really a radial spoke is only suitable for the front wheel of a light bike, often seen on fixies with no front brake. For that reason, you need tangent spokes to transmit power or braking. And some lovely ladies' tricycles on this side. And the museum lost a lot of the collection in 2014 when the family of Tom Morton, the co-founder, wanted the bikes back. But they've done a lovely job of spacing out. They've got some new bikes out of storage, new donations, and you'd never tell, really. As I'm whiffling on, I'm just showing you some of the things around on the wall. This is a particularly beautiful Rover-style bicycle. I don't know if it's a genuine Rover. And you see they haven't quite got the seat tube yet. They're still refining the diamond frame, haven't quite got there. And the cross frame was popular as well, which the main tube that splits halfway down, that one has a top tube in it. And then that's the American Star bicycle, the one that was famously driven down the Capitol steps. It's like an ordinary in reverse to prevent the header, with the small wheel being the steering wheel. That's a rather handsome example. Don't know whether it's original or replica, but it's beautiful nickel plating on it. And it's a replica, yeah, but very good. And then the tricycles are developing more into the type of tricycle that we would recognise today. There's a bike with the Simpson lever chain, which was meant to be more efficient, which was a load of rubbish really, but it was famously depicted in these Henri Toulouse-Lautrec adverts, which they paid him to do. The next hall, a wonderful camping scene depicting sort of mid-century English camping. Gorgeous Paris Galibier tandem. Sorry, it's just a Paris. Well, there must be three of them involved in this camping trip. He seems to be sulking outside of the tent with his cell back. Maybe he wasn't included. Let's get our minds onto more savoury things again. sign. I'll just linger there a few seconds. Beware of imitations, of which there were legion. You'll have the development into the bicycle as we know it today. Or as we know it, as Velocipedians, it's basically your roadster, pneumatic tyres, still got a 1-inch pitch chain, or skip tooth as the Americans call it, and then shortly after went to the 1/2-inch. That's still got the spoon brake though, but this one has the rod operated stirrup brake. Bamboo frames, always popular from the early days. The properties of bamboo were realised early on. Sprung frame, There we are, plunger rear. And basically the whole bike pivots around the middle. And another bamboo with a rather elegant curved down tube. A lovely 1910 Raj. And of course the golden sunbeam. With the oil bath chain case, there were acknowledged as the Rolls-Royce of bicycles back in the day, but of course pedestrian enthusiasts like myself would beg to differ. This is definitely one for the Raleigh Roadster Club. It's like I've died and gone to heaven. It's a three-dimensional rendering. I think it's painted onto the inside of the glass and then put into a 3D cabinet in the background. What a fantastic piece of Raleigh memorabilia that is. I've got another one to show you as we go out as well. Something absolutely mind-blowing. And that of course is Raleigh as well. Very sweet. Sadly, they don't correspond to a display of Raleigh cycles, although we do have a record ace here. That was my knees, if you heard that. Too many years of these things. Not just riding them, but bending down, fixing them. And the old cars. Now, the Pedersen, developed by a Dane. Mikhail Pedersen, who worked for the Lister Manufacturing Company in Dursley, Gloucestershire. Lister, who are famous for the stationary engines and other small agricultural equipment. Pedersen had actually designed various small agricultural appliances, including a creamer that became the industry standard. That set him up financially to be able to indulge his bicycle passion. But his poor business sense meant that Dursley Pedersen Bicycle Company was soon bought out by Lister. I don't need to go into that much detail on Pedersen cycles themselves, because I'm sure you're probably acquainted with them if you're watching this. But here are some original examples rather than the modern repros that we see. And in fact, it is, from an engineering point of view, a superb way of making a bicycle. And that is a step through ladies' frame. And there's Mikhail, and I think that's his, not sure which of his wives that is, I think that's Dagmar riding the ladies. Constructing one of these, there are I believe 92 braised joints or thereabouts, depending on how you do things like this. You could braise lots of pieces of metal, or you could cut a plate, and depending whether you use a modern headset in there, which the reproductions tend to use, the average is about 92 braised joints. And it's always been an ambition of mine to build a batch, and I fully intend to at some point down the line. I will make the jigs. I need an original or a repro to prototype from, and then I fully intend to build maybe half a dozen. Now that's exactly like one that I have. That's a spoke threading machine, and of course a wheel building jig. That looks like either a Bradbury or a Millennium. I have that sign in my workshop as well, but not in that condition. It's a lovely thing, look at this. This is the original RSW16, the Mark 1, but this is the folding version. Probably one of the worst folding bikes ever made. And there was a running joke that it's the only folding bike that takes up more space when it's folded than when it's intact. They didn't angle the fold, so when it folds, the back of the front tyre folds underneath and comes and meets the front of the back tyre. Whereas if they had offset the hinge slightly, it would have folded up against itself. Instead, it folds up and meets itself and stops there. Pretty useless. I do have a little soft spot for those bikes. Not the folding one, the original one with the white tyres in olive green. My mum had one, and when she couldn't cycle anymore, she passed it to me at the age of about 11. I'd just got my Carlton then, and I used the RSW as a runaround. Thoroughly enjoyed it. Typical 1920s ladies rally loop frame, the sort of thing that you would see the woman in the red coat and the rally adverts riding. In fact, the front of Tony Hadland's book comes to mind. Achilles, a model of strength. You need to keep looking upwards in this place as well. One for the Americans there, Schwinn runabout. The Triang Junior, the poorly built miniature Moulton. A Bickerton, that's the leader cranks, it must be getting on in the production run. Another nice wheel building stand, I think that's a Bradbury, which were made in Oldham, where when I took over the rally dealers, that was in Oldham, and that's where my Bradbury work stand came from. But there are treasures in here. Beautiful BSA, and look at this. One for Dave and Kevin and various people in the Rally Roadster Club, and Jeff. Late 80s Rally Chilton. Brand new one. In fact, this one is a 93. Very late. But up here is the one that I regard as treasure. Can't see the exact age, I'd say late 50s through to mid 60s. It's got the old steel bicycle transfers. And it's still got some of its original lining. It's not a new unused one, it's just a good example. And I have a couple of these. They make good desk calendars. I'll show you how they work at some point. Trent Sports in there. nice condition with the usual perished tyres. Lovely BSA, which it was the 24 inch wheel BSA safety shopper. Ooh, I might want that. There is so much in this place. The number of times I've been here, and still every time I come, I see new treasures. While we're in the Raleigh segment, here's another, don't think it's superb, no, it's black. It's just a popular or a dawn, I can't see exactly from here. But it has the Trojan mini motor. I think it's a Trojan, somebody will correct me if I'm wrong. It has a number plate because anything with an internal combustion engine in Britain has to be licensed as a motor vehicle, as does any e-bike which will propel itself without you pedalling. So they have to be registered, insured, taxed, licensed rider, etc. Lovely DSA, 1948. And we open up into another hall of delights. On the back of a fairly typical touring tandem of the day, with its Blue Mills Featherlight mudguards, we have the Watsonian sidecar. Now they're unlike a motorcycle sidecar, these. You see they've got a pivoting connector. Wing nuts to detach it from the bike, which leaving just a plate on there. But it pivots here, so you can still lean the bike. I really like one of those. My friend Alex has one. I have no use for them. I just like one. And another fine rally. Now, original transfers, the lining mostly polished off, but the original paint. What's that? 474 miles. That's a drum brake, not a dyno hub. I believe this is, oh, it does say sports on there. It looks almost like an all-weather model or a utility model, but it's got plating, so. Is there any clue? No clue in the information about what exact model it is. A lot of the what enthusiasts and veteran collectors regard as humdrum everyday models, the kind of bikes I'm into, of course don't have as much information on them as they're exhibited here. Typical sports bikes of mid-20th century, as is most of this hall. And then we have a fairly modern Batava Stutch bike alongside a beautiful, look at the colour scheme on this, a beautiful Sun Wasp. BSA power bike from World War II. '60s, '70s, '60s, Phillips. So there is some jumbling going on. Flying gate, and another one. like a kingpin, but it comes apart instead of folding. Lovely humber. Perfect partner to the brand new gents model that I discovered and rescued. We have the same age. Interesting corner. Woodruff of Leeds. Nice to see a Dawes Galaxy in here. Any cycle museum needs an example. And there is my teenage bike. Dawes Kingpin again. It's good to see bikes like that in here. RSW16. This is obviously a celebration of everyday utility cycling. Ithera plastic bicycles in both colours. Working bikes, of course. Ellswick Royal Mail. Typical low gravity, as they were known, with the small front wheel. The progenitor to the modern cargo trike of the Christiania type. We did it first. The Dutch backfeets alongside. Beautiful, beautiful RSC patrolman's bicycle. And of course, the police bike has to be a Raleigh. So a little bit further round, I was talking about the replica Pedersons earlier on, and here is one made by Sutton's, and otherwise known as the Norwich Pederson, as opposed to the Dursley. I don't need to tell you why. You see, they've used a simpler plate on here instead of that elaborate but rather handsome original one, and modern components. And principally, it's, they've gathered the tubes into a tube that goes from round to square, and then used a modern headset there. It's what many of the replicas reproductions do nowadays. It's a practical solution, particularly for people who want to use the bike. And these are the tensioning wires. So there's a certain degree, this is not brazed here, so there's a certain degree of flex in here. This isn't a brazed X, so the seat stays have quite a bit of flex in them deliberately, because you tension on this leather strap here. That saddle is very floppy, that should be very taut, and the tension is taken up on these wires or sometimes cables and the back end, and that down to the rear dropouts, and that provides the springiness in the frame. Anyone who shops at Evans, this is where they started out. My interest in cycle sport is pretty much zero, so therefore my knowledge on racing bikes is not far behind zero. It tends to be the speciality of most enthusiasts, and those same enthusiasts probably don't know much about the things that I'm into, so we're a broad church, there we are. So a lineup of racing bikes. However, there are a few of note that I do really appreciate. This is one of the infamous Dr. Swan's bikes, and it's a Cinelli. quite a few of these are kitted out as fast touring bikes for club day rides. A Flying Scot, which Billy Connolly fans might appreciate, is the bike that he's had most of his adult life. Tragically unable to ride anymore. And I don't get on with drop handlebars anymore either, so that's possibly part of my lack of interest in these bikes, but only I could come to a cycle museum with lightweight bikes, find a time trial bike, and it's a Gazelle. So just a little bit of background of the museum. It was an amalgamation of two major collections back in the day, David Higman and Tom Morton. Tom Morton's family had owned, I don't know if they still do own, this building, which is the Automobile Palace, a listed building in itself. And back in the day they had early motor cars, bicycles and aircraft in this space and the floor above. But it's in the centre of Llandrindod. The museum of course is a charity run by volunteers. So I'll put their website address in the description. So if you've enjoyed this virtual tour, please consider throwing a few quid their way. You have had a look around their museum after all. And it's a very good cause indeed. That's two bicycles joined together. Last but definitely not least, it's one of my favourite exhibits of all. This is not the Raleigh Superb that's been encased in anything or wood grained. This is entirely hand built. Incredible detail. Yeah.